important today, okay? And we talked yesterday about a couple of things, and it's very important. Blessed are the meek. Does anybody know what meek means? Meek. Say that word. It's kind of a funny word. Meek. Okay. Okay. Do you guys want to be separate? Okay, be good then. Do you want to know what meek actually means? I did not know this when I was little. When I was little, I didn't even know what the word meek meant at all. Then I turned into a teenager, and I learned that meek meant quiet. So blessed are you if you're quiet. That's not what meek means. You want to know what meek really means? It's kind of what meek means. It's not what meek means in the Bible. Do you want to know what meek means? Meek means you always turn to God. When you're in trouble, you turn to God. You always trust God. You always look to God for help. I have a question. If you're in trouble, who do you usually go to for help? Who helps you? Mila. Pardon? God. Oh, Mila, if you're in trouble, do you pray and ask God for help? That's so good. Maddie, you said your mom. That is very good. A lot of times if we're in trouble, guess who we go to for help? Our moms. Sometimes when I'm in trouble, do you know who I go to for help? Lincoln. I'm home alone with the kids, and if I need to do something, I'm like, oh, Lincoln, can you grab the blah, blah, blah? Can you help me? Guess what he says? Yes, he always says yes, every time. So that's I ask Lincoln for help a lot. I ask Matt for help a lot. And when I was younger, I used to ask my mom and my dad for help. When you're meek and you need help, you always turn to God. You always trust in God for your help. That's pretty amazing. We're going to hear a story today about a guy who did that. Now, I want to remind you about the gospel. Kids, if you, David, God is holy. And when you're holy, it means that you have no sin. You never do anything wrong. It's impossible to do something wrong. And you're so perfect, you can't even be with somebody or something that's not perfect. You can only be with perfect things. Question, are we perfect? No, but nobody is perfect. Put your hand up here if you've done something wrong before. If you one time did something wrong before. Everybody's hand should be up. I have done some wrong things. We all have. Sometimes people get angry and they yell. Sometimes people hit. Sometimes people don't want to share. Right? Sometimes people say mean things. Who has had somebody say a mean thing to you before? Put your hand up if somebody said a mean thing to you. A kid, your brother, sister, they said a mean thing. And he said a mean thing to you, Owen? Don't tell me what he said. I don't want to hear what he said, but I'm sorry that he said it to you, bud. Okay? I'm sorry. You can tell me after what he said if you want after, okay? Okay, thanks. Okay. You have there's a girl at your French school who's mean to you. It doesn't feel very nice, does it? Well, guys, God can't be with anybody who's mean, who can't be with anybody who's sinned, who's done anything, said anything, thought anything wrong. He can't be with you. So, question. He kicked your thumb, I remember. Okay, so now I have another question for you. If we are sinful, if we've done mean things or bad things before, Piper, then what are we going to do? How are we going to be with God? He can't be with us. What are we going to do? How are we going to get to be with God? Somebody explain to me. Guys, the punishment for our sin is that when we die, we're separated from God forever. How are we going to be with God if we've sinned? Mila. My question was, if we're sinners, if we've sinned and done bad things, and God is holy, he can only be with people who are perfect, how do we become perfect? How do we get to be with God? Can we do it by ourselves? Can we try really hard? Can we just try really hard? No, we can never try hard enough to be perfect. We'll never be nice enough. Even if we spend our whole life trying to be good, We still won't be perfect. We still can't be with God. How do we get to be perfect? How can we be forgiven for our sin? Luke. Pardon? Yes. Luke, he said it. We can pray to God and ask him to forgive us and trust in him and what Jesus did, because Jesus actually was perfect. He actually never sinned. He actually did obey God, and then he died in our place. We were supposed to die and be separated, and Jesus died and was separated from God instead. Isn't that amazing? And now God said, because of what Jesus did, my only son, I gave him to you, and he died for you. Now, if you trust in him, and if you believe in him, and if you ask him to forgive you, then you can be perfect because of Jesus. It's like we wear his robe of righteousness. His robe, his clothing of perfection, his perfect life, it's like that gets put over us. Did you guys know that? And all of our sin, it gets put on Jesus. We switch. It's amazing. That's a pretty big switch. All of my sin going on perfect Jesus and all of Jesus's righteousness coming on sinful me. That's what happens when we pray and we ask him to forgive us and we trust in him. And then we can be with God. Who thinks that's amazing? I am so thankful. Do you know how old I was when I prayed and asked God to forgive me? Put your fingers up of how old you think I was. I'll give you, it's on your, okay, well, you don't have 16 fingers. I'll give you a clue. You've got 10 fingers, so it's one of those. Two. So Mila thinks I was 2. 3, Lukey says. Those are not true. 10. Not 10? 10? No. Who said 4? I was 4. And you know what I told my mom? I said to my mom, because I went to church and I heard about Jesus and I heard what God did and I heard that I was a sinner and I heard that God made a way for me to be forgiven and made perfect. And then I said to my mom, Mom, I need to pray. And she said, okay, well, prayer's a good thing. Well, why do you need to pray? And I said, because I'm a sinner and I want to be with God, but I can't be. But he made a way. There's a way. And my mom was a Christian, so she knew. She goes, you're right, there is a way. What did your Sunday school teacher tell you? Jesus came. He died for me. I have to trust him. I have to pray and ask him to forgive me. I have to turn from my sin. I have to turn to Jesus. Then I can be saved. My mom was like, you're right. Let's pray. And we got down on our knees. You know where it was? By my garbage. My mom was changing the garbage when I asked her about it. So we prayed right by the garbage, and I prayed so hard, and I asked God to forgive me, and I told him, I want to turn to you, God. I want you to be my God. I trust you. Guess what? I was a Christian. I was God's child. Now, when I die, at the end of my life, whenever that is, I'm not going to be separated from God. I'm going to go to heaven to be with God. I'm so excited. And right now in my life, do you think God listens when I pray? Yes, he does. He listens to my prayers because I'm his child now and I'm saved. That's amazing. If you guys have any questions about that, ask your leaders or ask me. It's so important. It's why we're here at camp. I want to tell you about a king. Dante.
I turned to a Christian when I was 4.
I know you did, Dante. When you turned to a Christian, your mom called me, and she told me. You know what I did? One of those, and probably a cartwheel, because I was so happy about it. Very good, okay? So if any of you guys want to trust Jesus, you tell your leader about it, okay? Okay, I want to tell you about a king who turned to God. He was in big trouble. Solomon said his name, and I don't know if anybody remembers his name, but he was in so much trouble. He was the king of Judah, and his name was King Hezekiah. Can you say Hezekiah? And he was in his city, and his city was big, and it had a wall, a big stone wall. It was so thick, it was a very good place to be. It was safe. Except the entire Assyrian army. The Assyrians are the bad guys. That's another country. They came to get him. They came to fight. And they went all the way around the wall. And they started yelling up, Taylor, sit on your bum. Rocco, sit on your bum. Luke, sit on your bum. 5, 4, 3, 2. Quick, Marco, you can make it. And a 1. Okay. They surrounded Jerusalem. So if you were in your house and you looked out over the wall, army. You couldn't even stop. They would stretch. The army, there were so many soldiers, chariots, bows and arrows, swords and shields. No, there was so many, you couldn't even see the end of the army. You'd be looking, and it's like, it keeps going. I can't even see the end of them. They go on forever. That's what it was like around Jerusalem. And then they started yelling up to the king. And they said, they said to the king, King Hezekiah, you better give up because nobody can save you. Natalie, can you stop them? Nobody can save you. And don't think your God can save you because we just beat up every other country and their gods didn't save them. Because everybody worshipped false gods back then. Fake gods, not the real God, not our God, just our fake God. And so he said, don't think anybody can save you. I'm going to get you. I'm coming in there. We're going to break your wall down. We're going to kill everybody. You know what Hezekiah did? Do you think he was scared? Put your hand up if you think he was scared. I would have been so scared. So this is what Hezekiah could have done. Hezekiah could have cried. Hezekiah could have run away. He could have tried to run out the back. Hezekiah could have given up and said, oh, I give up. That's it, I give up. Come on in and take us. Do you know what Hezekiah did?
He prayed to God.
He was meek, Maddie. What does it mean to be meek? If you're meek, you always turn to
God.
You always turn to God. You always trust in God. Hezekiah was meek. The bad king of Assyria, the guy's name was Sennacherib. And I think Pastor Levi said Sennacherib. So maybe it's Sennacherib. This guy, this mean king, wrote a letter. Who can write? Who knows how to write words? He wrote words on a letter. And he said, I'm going to come and kill you, and you can't win, and there's no hope. And he gave the letter to Hezekiah. You know what Hezekiah did with the letter? Did he cry? He took the letter and he went like this. Letter? No. He took the letter. Letter? He put it down in the church, in the temple before God. He got on his knees and he prayed. And you want to know what he prayed? He prayed, Dear God, please, please win this battle, but not to save us. Win this battle so that everybody knows that you are God. I'm turning to you, Lord, and I want everybody, all these kings, all those other countries, I want them to know you're the one true God. What do you think happened? What do you think happened? It's amazing. Mila, God saved them in the night. Hezekiah prayed with the letter. He went to bed, maybe. And then in the night, the angel of the Lord, so God's angel came with a sword, and he killed 185,000 Assyrian soldiers in the night, in one night. So when the Assyrians woke up, guess what? You wake up and in your tent, guess what? The guy beside you is just dead. You come out. And all the people that were there the night before, but when you went to bed, there was a bunch of guys up, like, talking and stuff. They're all lying there dead. And you said, what happened? What happened? Who killed them?
God
answered Hezekiah's prayer because Hezekiah was meek, and Hezekiah turned to God. And so God answered his prayer. Guess what all the other Assyrian soldiers did when they saw all the dead people? Guess what they did? Is it Jasper or Aaron? Jasper, what did he do? Oh, you just got your, I thought that was your hand up. No?
They ran away.
Oh, and they ran back home. They were like, I'm getting out of here. And they ran back to Assyria. They left. And God saved his king, Hezekiah. They didn't bring any more armies. During Hezekiah's lifetime, nobody else, like the Assyrians, never came back. God saved his people big time. Pardon? Lukey, if you were the king of Assyria, if you were Sennacherib, and you brought your army to Jerusalem, and then in the night, mysteriously, like a surprise, like you don't know how it happened, you woke up and half your camp was dead, would you come back?
No.
I wouldn't. I would be afraid of that God. I would be like, that God's real. All the other gods, we attacked their people, nothing happened. We got away with it. But that God, the God of Judah, That's the real God. That's what they thought. He's real. Don't mess with the real God. He's too powerful. They didn't come back. Okay, so kids, what does it mean to be meek? You turn to God. Okay, I want everybody to stand up. Don't jump around. Don't be silly. Don't be crazy. Stand up. And I want you to say, when you're meek, you always turn to God. Okay? Instead of trusting yourself or trusting in somebody else, you trust in God. That's what it means to be meek. And, okay, sit down. When we learned about the gospel, how to be a Christian, it's the same thing. If you want to be a Christian, you can't be saved. You can't be with a holy God on your own. You have to turn to Jesus and ask Jesus to save you. Okay? You got to ask for God's forgiveness through Jesus, and you have to trust in Jesus. Let's pray, kids. You did such a good job listening. Let's pray. Close your eyes. Dear God, you are so good, and we love you. Thanks for saving Judah. Thank you, God, that Hezekiah was meek and he trusted in you. Lord, I'm so glad that he cared about what everyone thought about you. He wanted everybody to know you were real, the only real God. Thank you, Lord. I pray these kids would love you. I pray if there's kids here who don't know you, they would turn to you and they would trust you and ask you to forgive them. Just like Dante said, I pray they would become a Christian. He said he turned to a Christian when he was 4. And I pray that for these kids. We love you, Lord, in Jesus' name.